Okay, the second talk this afternoon is by Hugo Arendt, and he speaks about constructive proof of dependent choice compatible with classicalism.
Okay, so it's in the same series, the same spirit as what I showed about Markov principle, how to have a proof as program approach to such kind of axiom rather than a realizability approach. But the idea is that if you justify axiom by realizability, you just extract the computational part, but to justify the logical part, you still appeal to the same axiom at the meta level. To avoid that, you can try to directly interpret the proof computationally, justifying also the logical part. So here, the underlying idea of bar recursion to interpret dependent choice in arithmetic together with the classical logic, but then in direct style, in a proof as program style, not using realizability. So basically, this is what I just said. So the framework is about capture the countable choice on dependent choice. So it's similar to what Spector did. It's similar to work made by Coquin, Berardi, Bezem at the end of the 90s. Here it's really starting from proof and starting from two observations. First observation is that if we are in Martinov type theory, we can compute with the full intentional axiom of choice. It's very easy, very elementary. You just take the strong projection of an existent choice, which is a symmetric. So then, axiom of choice in general should be no problem. So that's the first point. Second point, we know since Griffin at the beginning of the 90s that we can compute with classical logic. That means that classical logic has a computational content which is not just an oracle which will magically decide whether we are on the right or left hand side of the disjunction, but that there is a process, a computational process, which puts an interaction between a proof of A and a proof of or a proof of not A, a bit like the copycat strategies in game semantics. So then we can compute with classical logic, we can compute with the axiom of choice, the full intentional axiom of choice. So we should be able to compute with the axiom of choice in the presence of classical logic, which just meets the two computations. But it does not work. It does not work. It doesn't produce typing if you combine the two computational contents. So this has been observed by several people. You can observe it when you try to do the CPS translation, the double negation translation of axiom of choice. You arrive to need the principle of double negation shift, because classically an existent choice is a not exist. So then, when you have a for all exist implies there is a function, and classically it's the same, morally I say for all not exist, but how do you extract the witness when you have a not exist, you don't have any more that exist to take the witness out. So something has to be done, and something can be done, and this something which can be done allow to capture not the full axiom of choice, the full intentional axiom of choice, but enough to get the axiom of choice on the countable domain, like countable choice or dependent choice. So this is what I explain. So let's give my notation. So I'm using, I'm reasoning in a proof as program setting. So every time I'm considering a proof of a formula and annotating the proof by But I annotated the second by the proof as a term. So usually we leave implicit the proof as being the name of the inference rule. Here I reflect the name of the inference rule as an annotation of the terms, as the annotation of the second. This is a standard way to think as proof as program. A proof is like a lambda term, and we represent that a statement is proven is the same as the proof is a lambda term of some type, which is the formula. So here this just means I have a proof of this formula. So if I have a proof of this formula, then Martynov's way to get a sum of choice is just to allow the first projection which I write to it. So often it's by one or first. And the second projection which I call proof, the second projection is dependent on the first. This is where we have arrived with dependent type theory. But this allows then to have a proof, a very simple proof, computational of the axiom of choice, is just distributing the lambda over the projection. And this proof, so then we have this on one side. Then on the other side we have classical logic. So classical logic, there are many ways to compute, many kind of operator we can add to logic to compute with classical logic. In programming language, it's usually called CC. I like to separate them in two parts. One part which is called catch, and another which is called throw, which morally is like a double negation elimination, except that we do it in a more precise way. We don't consider the negation of the formula as a formula. We have a more primitive notion of being the negation of, which is what I write with this A double bottom. A double bottom is not a formula, it's a notation to say I have the refutation of A. So if you want, it's like if I have written A on the right hand side, but I wrote it on the left hand side, and using second calculus when you get classical logic by having multi-conclusion. Like in the previous talk with Scott inference domain, Scott entailment relation, where you have several formulae on the right, but instead of several formulae on the right, I wrote them on the left with this symbol. And this allowed to say that I have a focus on one special formula, which is the one I'm working on. And then, classical logic is just allowing contraction, somehow it amounts to that. If I to prove a formula A, I can keep a copy of the formula A, and I can reuse this copy if the alpha of type refutation of A is in the context, which means I use a catch. Then I can give a new proof of A. So classical logic is backtracking to prove an existential statement. I'm allowed to give several times a witness. And for instance, the drinker paradox is a typical example of classical proof. I give some witness, an arbitrary of the domain, which is supposed to be null and empty. And then, for all other persons in the group, if the first is drinking, then the second is drinking. So the trick is to I'm asked about another person, then I change my view and say, oh, the one who is drinking is the one I'm asked for to show that he drinks. And as a proof as program, it's written like this. So we allow a contraction, we give a proof within a witness, it's a pair, which witness an existential. I give a proof of the for all y by getting a y, and what I do, I do a catch to change the focus of the formula, it's an irrelevant one, so this is that. But what is important is I throw back a new witness. I throw a new witness for the distinction. So such a proof backfires on the choice of a witness. So what it means then to take the first projection of such a proof, because we have several witnesses, we don't have any more one witness. So this part then is how to compute with specific logic. On this slide, I precisely show also that the proof I have for axiom of choice in Martinov type theory doesn't work anymore if we interpret the existential here as classical, which means that not exist in morally, in direct sense, that we hide the not in the syntax of classical logic. What is to take the witness when there are several witnesses? So I will give a criterion to when we can have a witness. But first, let's go by step. Typically in this view, for all x I have possibly many y, and I have to build the function. So I have to build the function which is consistent. Which is consistent. Over all value of x. For all x, I have several values, but I have to build one function. For each x, which y do I choose, which is in a consistent way? So one way to do it, one first trick in this work to get axiom of dependent choice, is to turn a quantification of a natural number into an infinite conjunction. And this is why I will get axiom of countable choice and axiom of dependent choice, and not the full axiom of choice, is that it works when the domain is countable, and it works when I can turn the quantification as an infinite conjunction. And why is it better if I take an infinite conjunction? Is that now I can rephrase my proof of axiom of choice by saying, I will take for each n, I will take the nth component of the infinite conjunction. But now, since it's an infinite conjunction, to evaluate it, even if each member is classical, I can start by first computing a witness classically for it. And for this witness, there can be several, but for this witness, I can fix it and continue to compute with this one, and I get one, and possibly later on by means of continuation of the computation. But I have the first one fixed, the second one fixed, locally fixed, and then I can take the third one, and then I can share the computation, and I can ensure if I create somehow compute externally to the proof of axiom of choice, I compute this in advance externally. I can build a consistent approximation of a choice function. So this is one of the tricks I use to build this to have a proof of countable and dependent choice. Or if we think in terms of computing, it's like we can compute a number, but we can compute a pair of numbers, we can compute a triple. If we have an infinite conjunction, we can compute it as far as we want. We can compute a finite approximation as far as we want. But if we have a function, it's not the same. A function where you are blocked on waiting the argument. So this is some of the tricks that in computing we can compute a pair where we cannot compute a function because the function expects an argument. Okay, I think I have to maybe to go faster. So then, the trick, I presented the first trick, which is, which is to use infinite conjunction. And then we have to show that we can encode in arithmetic such kind of infinite conjunction. Okay, so let's let you pause to present the logic, to present the details. This is I'm defining IT arithmetic in finite type. This is system T, so there is nothing complex. The standard calculus with the recursor in all types, and the reduction rule for the recursor. So these are the formula I will consider, the standard formula with Lejeune's equality, and the quantification in all finite types. And so apparently it's something is missing here, but these are the rules. So again, presented in a proof-as program style. So it's it makes things quite maybe a bit complex, but we can see, for instance, the disjunction. A proof of a disjunction is just a case analysis of a proof of A1 or A2, and if we are the A1 case, we continue with a proof of B, which is P1, and otherwise we continue with a proof of P2, which is a proof of B, and so on. So we have, it's just a standard rule, standard introduction and elimination rule for natural deduction, plus rules for equality and for induction. So we are in the proof as program style, so we should so the idea is that we shall justify the logic on the consistency of the logic by means of computation directly in the logic, so which means that we shall equip the logic with a cut elimination procedure. And this set of rules maybe it looks a long list, but basically it's a way to express cut elimination, normalization in the logic. So it's a way to tell how the logic computes when we see the proof as program. So typically the first rule is beta reduction. So it's basically the fact that an introduction rule of implication followed by an application simplify in Prawitz natural deduction. So these are the rules for all, to a cut elimination of a cut of the for all, and so on. So note that the logic has a let. Why has a let? So in programming, we have different ways to compute, which are called by name and called by value. Called by value means that when we have an application, in particular here, we expect that Q is first evaluated to a value, which is something which starts with a constructor. And this is important for what we are doing, precisely because this proof, to ensure that our proof of the infinite conjunction is consistent, we will first evaluate it into a value. So not strictly a value because it's infinite, but a value as far as we need that it is a value. And the kind of evaluation in programming which requires call by value requires a let operator to express the order of evaluation. So there is a let. And the let implies a number of extra rules also for evaluation. And we see that the let shall be unfolded only when we have a value. This is similar to the computational lambda calculus of Moji for the okay, so a remark in passing is that writing arithmetic in finite type as a notion of co-inductive type, if we end, so there is a second order encoding, standard second order encoding of co-inductive type, but we can encode second order quantification by means of second order function symbol. So we can just simulate an infinite conjunction in a second order encoding, which I shall not detail, but which is this one. However, this second order encoding is a bit complicated because it has an implication of that, as I said, a lambda fraction is not so easy for call by value evaluation. So we shall instead, but it's logically equivalent, use a primitive notion of co-inductive type. So it's basically a finite description of the infinite conjunction. So a co-inductive type, it's this small thing. So there is, it's a binder, so it's a new fixed point over a formula A. The fixed point is over a symbol F, which represents the second order variable. T is the initial value, because the fixed point, the co-inductive type is dependent on some terms, like to express this co-inductive, this, where was it? So then, as I said, to describe an infinite conjunction, so this I use this, I use this notation, and for instance, so with A, which is a recursive pattern depending on F, for instance, this expression represents the expansion P of X, where at each F, I expand the co-fixed point, so I have an infinite sequence. This is the initial value as I start from 3 and so on. Okay, but then, in this co-inductive type, I can have recursive objects, co-recursive objects, which are defined by a co-fixed point. So I have, again, a proof P, which depends on the same parameter X, this time not F, but a proof of F of X equal 1, and an initial value T, and this co-fix will unfold. It's a finite way to describe an infinite process. So to have a co-fix means that I have a new operator and then new reduction rule. And this co-fix is expected to be evaluated so that when I compute then the function, the choice function, it has a fixed value, so it has to be shared. So this is expressed by every time I have to evaluate a co-fix, I keep one copy of it by using a let, and I share this copy in all cases I will use later on. For instance, as this computation can duplicate the co-fix point. So then I have a quite complicated evaluation mechanism.
No,
it's not a problem of
P. No, mais on a plus battu encore en fait.
There is a kind of, so it's not term notation to describe what happened in cut elimination of with an inference rule. There is a kind of context which express when we have an infinite conjunction to evaluate, so that it's shared. Okay, so then we have new rules for classical logic, and the important point is how to make another important point is how to make the strong sum of Martinov style compatible with classical logic. And there is a very simple way to do it, which is enough to have an axiom of choice, which is to restrict P to be what is called, what I call N elimination free, but basically means that it's a value. It will not have side effect. It will not call classical logic. It will not call a catch. So it's a recursive definition, but it's, it basically means that when I instantiate the free variable by value, I get the value. And then, with that, so I will skip dependent choice, which is a bit more complicated than axiom of choice, but the proof I had before works. The proof I intended at the beginning, here, with an infinite projection, is now possible on by the method. Still, one point I will say of dependent choice is that it's very amazing that we can get dependent choice by building an infinite conjunction which meets an infinite object which meets conjunction and existential. So there is a nesting of existential in the definition of the productive object. So the X1 range over all the string, and the X2 over all the string after the first step, and so on. So these are the standard properties of a lambda calculus. So it's done so that it was without this restriction, it wouldn't have worked. We have subject reduction, so which means that when we compute, we preserve the proof that we have. Normalization. So the normalization has been. So I had only a sketch on the. It's only recently that a complete proof has been done by means of a classical realizability model to deal with called by me lambda calculus. Because why called by me? Because it's called by value with infinite objects which we cannot compute without infinite amount of time. So we compute them by necessity, by need. So there is a kind of called by need of sharing of this object. And Etienne Miquet, who was a PhD student, made an adaptation of classical realizability to deal with called by need on the calculus and get a normalization. So it has also, there are enough rules so that we get value, which constructors. So then, this implies that this language of proof behaves like a programming language. We can compute if we have, for instance, a closed formula of some type T, we can evaluate the proof and get a value. So if it's a sigma 0,1 formula, it will evaluate to a witness for this formula. And since 0 equal 1 is a sigma 0,1 formula which has no inhabitant, we have, of course, consistency. I'm almost done with the slide. Okay, this is a comparison with other work, which I shall skip if you don't mind. I want also, I didn't investigate it a lot, but if I'm correct, we can derive also bar induction just by adding just Markov principle, so not just full classical logic, but just this sigma types plus this restriction for this sigma type with a restriction to elimination free, plus Markov principle, plus the productive type. We have a computational form of bar induction. Somehow I would like to finish by saying that something which I like in this work is that somehow it's combined various ideas of coming both from logic and computation, like call by need, which is essentially something studied in the context of programming, sigmatized, which are more in the context of logic, computing with classical logic, which comes from programming, and so on. So I like this mix of culture.
Yeah? A question regarding this bar induction. Don't you need some condition on the bar, like monotonicity or Desirability of the bar to know where to stop.
If I'm correct, B can be arbitrary, but the predicate to which I eliminate has to be desirable.
Ah, okay.
So it's a strong restriction.
I thought normally the bar is kind of good, but it's a...
Yes, okay, but a priori I don't need it in the proof.
So I try to understand what it means if you're applying our dependent choice in a series. So say Hickman's lemma, uses dependent, Hickman's lemma, uses dependent choice. Okay, if you do the A translation with reliability, then in the end you get a program which relies on the bar as a function for the dependent choice. So what would be the equivalent now in your approach?
What if we compute?
Yes, what would, how would the program look like?
for Hickman's lemma, I don't know. Thank you. I worked with Marcel Mala sometime, and I was not able to understand the group, what's happening in the profile.
But what
sort
of construct would it use? Would it use the...
But I think it's typical, we can see typically in this proof that every computation which uses, so the statement is here, every computation which uses the axiom of countable choice means that it will provide a proof of this and get a function. And this will work by what is called continuation passing style. So if there is classical logic, which means that if you have a sigma 0,1 formula, there will be the rest of the proof which shall prove the sigma 0,1 formula shall be duplicated as many times as the exist f is provided. Because see, if the exist y here is classical, there shall be several y, and then there shall be consistent. Also, several f which are provided, not just one function. But the proof of this might backtrack also on proof and give several functions. But it will be at every time finer and finer approximation of the function we need. And it will terminate precisely because the counter proof is continuous and we use only a finite part of the function. But basically, it computes for n equals 0. Some first witness, depending of the interaction, it can compute a second witness for y, and then maybe the proof will ask for n of 3, so it will compute the first witness for 1 and 2, and then for 3. But then along the computation, there will be maybe a backtrack on the witness of 3, and then a new choice function will be provided. Maybe at some time the computation says that we have to backtrack on the value given to n, and then it's a bit like bar recursion. I mean, you have an approximation.
Yes,
it's morally it's the same kind of computational content as bar recursion, but with a full typing, not a simple typing, but typed with a language of formula.
So I think we have to stop here. So, thank you.